This is it. The 30th running of the most prestigious event on the PCC Cup Series calendar, the Cleveland Grand Prix. This year brought with it the largest entry list ever seen at this event, with an astounding 113 teams taking part in Cleveland Speed Week. Of those 113 teams, only 42 could qualify. As we go through the unlucky teams that were unable to qualify for this race, one name stands out above the rest. Points leader Barry Juveno, DNPQed in front of his home crowd. This means that Andy Lambert, driver of the number 15, only has to finish 34th or better to lock up the championship. Taking the pole for the Cleveland Grand Prix is Blake Camphausen in the number 51 for Johnson Racing. As he brings the field to the green flag, Christopher Loxton and his teammate qualified second. Greg Maddux qualified third. Grigory Novakovsky got a great run. He started fifth on the inside. And he pulls into the inside and blocks Blake Camphausen. Camphausen has nothing to do, but he has to lift. He's trying to get back to the lead. However, Christopher Loxton and his teammate from second place will take the lead over Grigory Novakovsky and Sam Smith. Blake Camphausen falls back to third, and it appears he might have gotten a little bit of damage there. Loxton, he has pulled out to a big lead over Sam Smith. Loxton in his last start as well. He's going back to finish rally car next year. He is trying to prove his worth in front of the Cleveland crowd. They love this kind of racing, this 3-4-5 wide business here back in the pack. This is Brendan Kelly. He's running in about 25th place right now. It's a nightmare for the drivers and the spotters and the teams in general, but the fans, this is what they look for all season. They look forward to this all season, and as you can tell, it is a jam-packed house here at Cleveland. Loxton in the 31 leads lap one. Sam Smith has managed to get around Novakovsky for second place. Smith has been the fastest car on the track in the recent practice sessions, so he might be a force to reckon with. This is Smith's last race for Aftershock Racing, the team that fields the car that he drives, and Andy Lambert, the championship leader. Lambert is going to drive for ROG Motorsports next year, the 34 car. However, we're not quite sure where Smith is going yet. Back in 37th place, Fozzy D'Annunzio gets hooked by Salvatore Torregrossa there in the 2 Tino, the number 42 car, the Scuderia Pasta car, battling back there for about 37th. Blake Camphausen pits from 5th place on lap 3. It appears that he did get damage, as you see on the right side of that car, and that upset the handling, I guess. So, tough break for that number 51 crew. They're looking for a good run. By lap 4, it's already clear who has more horses under their hood, as Sam Smith is quickly catching Christopher Loxton there in that 5 car. The gap has been reduced to almost nothing by lap 4. Same lap. Here is Steve Hansen in the 018. He gets into Nikos Kostopoulos, sweeps across the track into Ike Durbin. Both cars spin out. AJ Murphy collects a little bit of damage there in that 76 car. Both Steve Hansen and Ike Durbin were one-offs that managed to qualify for this race. Good job for them to make the show, but they're not doing much with that. This is Grigory Novakovsky. He's running in third place in the number 59. This is a third Griffith Motorsports car, and this is a test race for Novakovsky as he's running for Rookie of the Year next year in the 49 car. He's bringing his sponsor Kaspersky Lab to that car, and he's showing that he is a very capable road racer at this point. Steve Hansen, involved in that wreck earlier, he brings that car to pit road, that 018 Interstate Batteries car. Tough break for the Team Herp car. They tried to qualify Sean Rada as well, but he broke down during his pre-qualifier. Lap 6, the 72 of Nikos Kostopoulos breaks down entering turn 1. He pulls to the outside, and his car is slowing down rapidly. Here are the leaders on lap 6, and there is Nikos Kostopoulos stalled in one of the turns. They had to slow down to get around him, and that, frankly, is a pretty stupid move if you ask me. Why you don't just pull the car off and get a tow back to the pits is just beyond me. But still, Nikos Kostopoulos is trying to get back to the pits. AJ Murphy pits on lap 6 as well to repair some of that damage that he received when Steve Hansen spun in front of him. He got collected in that little ordeal there. This is Claire Ossier running in 5th place. Ossier is trying to pull off a miracle, trying to win the championship. It doesn't look like it's going to happen because Andy Lambert is the odds-on favorite. He only has to finish 34th or better to lock it up. But Austere is doing all she can. She's running in fifth place right now, right behind David Krikorian in the 35. You just saw him right there. Here's a nice story. Lenny Jacobs, who subbed for Brian Gallagher early in the year when he was out with an injury, is driving in 30th place with a car owned by Brian Gallagher. This car, loaned to him by Paloma Autosport, it's been very fast in the qualifiers. It almost got into the top 10 in pole qualifying, but wasn't quite fast enough. Here's Salvatore Torregrossa and Azuma Kazuyama going at it for about 35th position. They're trying to do what they can with their cars, but nothing quite seems to be working. They're just not quite handling as well as the cars up front. Tough break for these guys back here. They were hoping for a better showing in their one race. Nikos Kostopoulos, he managed to get his car refired. He's currently four laps down, but he's still soldiering on. The fighting spirit from that Garcia Aragon Motorsports team, it's doing them a lot of good. Well, I mean, not quite in this case, but it's showing that they might be back as championship contenders next year. Sam Smith has closed the gap to almost nothing on Christopher Laaksonen. You see there, he makes a move, but he checks up because Laaksonen didn't quite get through that turn as well as he was hoping. Laaksonen trying to hold on to the lead as long as he can in that 31 car in his last race, I should mention, as well. Lap 11, Azuma Kazuyama brings his car into the pits. It appears he got a bit of damage when he rear-ended Salvatore Torregrossa in the Scuderia Pasta Tutino there. Tough break for that 38 crew. They're going to go a lap down. This has not been the race for Garcia Aragon Motorsports. Both of their cars are having problems by lap 12. Fazi DiAnenzo now, he's been running in the back, and he's going to fall out with some issues with that car. You see here, Sam Smith is making a move on the outside in turn 1. Not many cars have been able to do that, especially in the pre-qualifiers. You see here, Sam Smith, he's taking the lead on the outside from Christopher Laaksonen. He will pull it off. Entering turn 3, your new leader, Sam Smith, trying to impress crowds. He's looking for a ride next season. He's trying to get a ride, and he's going to be leading the Cleveland Grand Prix here on lap 13. This is the battle for 28th place. They've been running each other pretty hard lately. Sergei Yakovsky, he gets into Josh Marshall there, and what's going on up ahead? Dave Endicott and Lenny Jacobs get together. Endicott stops on the track for some reason, and I think Lenny Jacobs slid into the outside wall. Let's get another look at this. Endicott here, he breaks for the turn, and Jacobs just doesn't. I think the throttle might have hung on that 8 car, but both cars will go out of the race on lap 14. Tough break for both of those one-offs. They were really hoping for a good showing today. Sam Smith has been pulling out to a huge lead. He's been pulling out a lead about a second a lap now over Christopher Laaksonen, and I guess we know who's got the better car this week. Brian Gallagher is back in the number 12 car. He's been gone since Dwyer. It's about 7 races he's been gone. Lenny Jacobs has been subbing for him, and that's why he gave him a ride in that Gallagher Motorsports number 8. But Lenny Jacobs doing a good job in his return here. He's running in 7th place. Cameron Taylor. I don't know where to start with this team. You would normally be seeing Andrew Tamarzan in this ride if Cameron Taylor didn't buy it out with all his sponsors. I don't know why they let him do this. He's running in 15th place right now, which honestly I think Tamarzan would be doing a better job. I don't know why they let Cameron Taylor in that car. Lap 18, here's JC Carpenter. He's battling with Greg Woodard for the 27th position. We'll talk about Woodard later. I guess he decided to overdrive the turn there, went a bit wide, and what is Dave Hetzel doing? JC Carpenter gets hooked, and Impact Racing makes an impact into the tire wall. Not quite sure that's the impact they wanted to make on this race, but JC Carpenter falls out on lap 18 due to some questionable driving from that 166 car. Sam Smith continues to lead on lap 5 with Richard Dean MacGyver right there behind him. I believe we missed MacGyver as well as Josh Marshall pitting. We apologize for that. Here is Ian Walker in the 10 car running in 10th. He's doing a good job so far. He's been having a pretty rough season so far. So this run, I'm sure, is a warm welcome to that team. Zach Meyer in the 25 is also having a great run there in 11th place right behind him. Salvatore Torregrossa's day ends early on lap 23 when his Tutino, well, this car wasn't too well funded to begin with. I mean, they've got a attorneys at law sponsor on the car. I believe that's the phone number of the company on the sides of that car. But they did what they could with that car, and they're gonna drop out after 23 laps. This is Chris Benson. He's running in sixth place in this 83 car. He hadn't even seen this track or even heard of it, surprisingly, before coming here for Cleveland Speed Week. He's doing a great job. He's running in sixth place. He's going to be running the 5 car next year for the same team, running for Rookie of the Year. Christopher Loxton must have been using up his equipment earlier in this run, because he's running about a second or so slower than everybody else. David Kerkorian makes a pass on Loxton for second place. You see right there that 35 car goes flying by the number 35 car. I believe the name above his window says the Flying Hebrew, and he certainly is living up to that name. He's absolutely flying at this point. He went from 19th place to 4th on the first lap, and now he's moved up to 2nd place. He's catching the leader pretty fast. I had mentioned Greg Woodard before. We're going to give him a bit more screen time now. And this is the number 111. He's debuting the Lycoya Interceptor. It's a new brand of car that's being released here in America. And his team, Terra International Motorsports, as well as Retro 80 Racing, the 84, 85, 86, they're going to be running this next year. Woodard's doing all right in his debut. He's running in 27th, keeping his nose clean, which is more than some other people have been doing. Blake Camphausen drops out. Valve problem. No wonder he was kind of slow off the grid there. Tough break for him. Craig Yonser is going to be taking over that car next season, bringing Scarabs along as a sponsor. Sergei Yakovsky kicks off green flag pit stops on lap 30, and he's going to bring in the rest of the field here. The same lap, Sam Smith brings his car into the pits, and his crew is radioing him to take the car straight to the garage. There's something wrong with the car. I believe it's a rear suspension housing, they're saying, and this is a horrifying development for this team. Aftershock Racing in their final start. Sam Smith looking to get a ride for next season. I guess it's just not meant to be, as you see him pulling into the garage there. Just a tough break overall for him. He was looking really strong here today. But that means that David Kerkorian, the Flying Hebrew, I guess we can start calling him now. He takes the lead, and he's got a big lead over the rest of the field. However, before Kerkorian can get a chance to lead, Grigory Novakovsky hasn't pit yet. Here, he brings Claire Osier with him, and the rest of the field who hasn't pit yet, into the pits. Novakovsky gets to lead the lap, and he pulls his car into the pits soon afterwards. Andy Lambert also pit this lap. He's currently running in 6th in the cycle, but before that he was running 13th, looking in great shape to take this championship once and for all. David Kerkorian finally takes the lead on lap 34. He's got about a 20-second lead on the rest of the field, and he's just, well, flying. No better words to say. David Kerkorian, he's looking to be a teammate to Andy Lambert, and that's going to be a definite boost, especially if Lambert wins the championship here today, which it's looking like he's going to do. There's not too many cars left that need to fall out to make sure he gets the championship. Stringfellow Vincent in the 84 for Retro 80 Racing, he's running in 4th place. This team's switching to the Lycoya Interceptor next year, and that's going to be interesting to see. This team has been performing pretty well all season. Andy Lambert, he currently is about to lock up the championship. There's only 35 cars still running at this point. If one more car falls out, he wins the championship, basically, as he's running ahead of Preston Bell, who's having a pretty miserable day at this point. Chris Benson, he pulls into the pits. Header problem with that car. And that means that Andy Lambert basically locks up the championship at this point. Chris Benson, tough break for him, though. He was running in 4th place. He had managed to get by the 84 car for that position. This is John Brachi and John Smith battling for the 12th position. This battle's been going on for a good while now, and both drivers have been having a pretty rough season so far. Well, both are out of the top 30 in points, but they're doing a good job today. They're both keeping their noses clean. They've stuck to battling each other for a while, and it's been an exciting battle. Fourth place seems to be the cursed position, as Stringfellow Vincent, he slows a lot coming into the final stretch here, and it's really a tough break for this team because they've been doing all they could to, you know, get up to the front, and this is their last race with Omeka, and I'm sure they're happy to finally leave this team after its questionable reliability. One of the one-off cars that's been searching for pace all week is the number four car here of Ike Durbin. He's running in 25th place, and he's just been barely squeaking through everything. He barely got through his pre-qualifier. He lucked into his position, kind of, well, through attrition in the main qualifier, and now he's running kind of off the pace in the race. Here's the most successful one-off so far, Grigory Novakovsky, and he's having a great race in his debut. He's running in third place, and he's catching Christopher Laaksonen slowly but surely. This car may look familiar. It's the same 16 that was at Decatur with Rick Phillips. Rick Phillips, again, is driving, and he's using this car as a test bed for the 2012 Tenere. The 2012 Tenere will have a hood scoop, however, the body lines are going to be slightly different. He's running research and development parts right now, and so far he's doing all right. He's running in 20th place, where Brian Gallagher in the 10 is in the top 10 all race. Here are his two teammates, Edward Carroll and Cody Deek, running 16th and 17th respectively. These cars have been clawing for speed, you could say, lately, but they've been kind of off the pace all week. They're running decently at this point. David Kerkorian in the lead. No, there's something wrong with the car. There's something wrong with the 35, as you see him pull off here. I think he's got a puncture on that 35 car, and he's trying to nurse it back to the pits. This happened in the absolute worst place. You gotta feel so bad for David Kerkorian. Here's Christopher Laaksonen as he passes Kerkorian in his stricken car for the lead. Laaksonen in his final start, trying to get the lead, but you've got to feel for David Kerkorian. He had a 20-second lead, and it all fell apart right then and there. Just nothing the team could do, and there's Novakovsky, who's quickly catching that number 31 car. Christopher Laaksonen looking for one final win in his final start here at the 30th annual Cleveland Grand Prix, and no, his engine blows! Just the worst luck right as he took the lead. His engine blows up. I don't believe it. Does anybody want to win this race? Is the lead a cursed position? First Smith and Kerkorian and now Laaksonen? I don't believe this. This is absolutely ridiculous. And now Grigory Novakovsky, in his debut, he takes the lead from Christopher Laaksonen's stricken car, and now Steve Hansen blows up in the 018 the lap later. This is absolutely ridiculous. I'm not sure if these guys had their cars geared for just surviving the main qualifier or what, but now Ian Walker's having a problem from ninth place. What is this? This is ridiculous. I've never seen anything like this. So many cars are breaking down with it. So close to each other, I don't understand.
И это для наших русских аудиторий. Григорий Новаковский в первой позиции. Он очень быстрый сегодня, и я не удивлюсь, если он заканчивается хорошо.
After suffering a puncture from in the lead, David Kerkorian has managed to move himself into 23rd position. He's still on the lead lap somehow, but he's battling with Sergei Yakovsky right now, the other Russian in the field, for 22nd place. Sergei Yakovsky right in front of him. Brian Gallagher makes an unexpected pit stop from 4th place, and despite what you are thinking right now, he is not going to fall out of the race. This is simply just an unscheduled pit stop for the number 12. Thank goodness for that. We've had enough blow-ups already. Claire Ossier is not known for taking advantage of other people's mistakes. However, she's worked her way up into second place due to attrition, and this is looking to be a pretty good day for her. She might be able to pull something off in the championship if her luck holds out. However, Andy Lambert is pretty much locked up the championship at this point. This is the battle for third place between Samuel Brown, that ride by our Cameron Taylor, and Zach Meyer in fourth place. This has been the running order for the past few laps now, and Cameron Taylor is making some headway in that number 53, and that team should be probably feeling pretty good about putting him in that car, because Cameron Taylor is doing a lot with a little, I guess you could say, because he is just stretching that equipment as far as it can go. Zach Meyer, he makes a pass on that ride buyer, Cameron Taylor, and Zach Meyer, in his underfunded Steelhawk number 25, he moves into third place. This is looking to be a career day for Zach Meyer. He hasn't done much all season. He's actually missed about half the races or so. Last year he won at Green Valley Motorplex, but nothing close to that this season. Great run here for Sam Meyer. He's running in the top three. Lap 59, Grigory Novakovsky in the 59 continues to lead over Claire Ossier. However, Ossier has managed to cut that gap from 8 to 4 seconds in the course of 7 laps, which is looking a bit troubling for the Russian. Also, when I had talked about Zach Meyer before, I had said top 3, I had meant top 4, excuse me for that. Ian Walker is running in about 30th place, and looks like something failed on that car. He would stall on the track, and that would be the end of his day. Tough break for that Evans Motorsports crew. They were looking for a great run early on. Just car couldn't hold it, I guess. Nicholas Korodovos kicks off green flag pit stops on lap 61. Korodovos has been having a pretty good run so far. He's been running in the top 15 all day. Stringfellow Vincent's day has gone from bad to worse. Now it goes from worse to terrible as the ignition system fails on his number 84. I guess when he had broke down earlier, that was a sign that something was going wrong. I guess this Retro 80 Racing team is going to be glad to finally be rid of Omeka, because the Lycoya that's in the race, Greg Woodard, seems to be running quite fine at the moment. Claire Ossier, Grigory Novakovsky, and that ride by our Cameron Taylor pit the next lap. And the lap after that, Zach Meyer decides to bring his car to the pits. The number 25 Steelhawk Tsar Eagle, he gets a lap led before Grigory Novakovsky takes the lead the next lap. Novakovsky is looking really strong here. However, the next lap... Oh, what's going... Does anybody really want to win this race? Novakovsky has to come in for a loose wheel. How can the pit crew make a stupid maneuver like that? That's four cars now as you see Ossier go by for the lead. Now, Ossier, the Quebecois driver, she leads over Zach Meyer by a fair margin of about a second or two. And now we're going to experiment with some pretty cool cameras we have here. They're mounted on the apex of the tire walls in the turns. As you see Ossier go by, and there's Meyer. This is Ossier's, well, this is Clockwork Team Lexus's final race. They're becoming Manticore Engineering next year, a group that actually says they know what they're doing, I guess. And here in 9th, 10th, and 11th are all three Griffith Motorsports cars. We've got Isaac Kowalczyk, Nicholas Korodovos, and Grigory Novakovsky running in those positions. Novakovsky managed to recover from his pit stop pretty well. And here Zach Meyer gets by Claire Ossier for the lead. I guess Ossier doesn't want to be in the lead, especially after she's seen what happened to Smith, Krikorian, and a couple other people. And Ossier, I guess she wants to be as far away from the lead as possible as she slides into the grass and lets Cameron Taylor, the ride buyer, go by there for second place. So Ossier now back to third. Not sure if something's wrong with that car, like what's been happening with the rest of the leaders, or she just wants to get the heck out of there. Now Zach Meyer, he opens up a big lead over Cameron Taylor. Zach Meyer in this family run 25, they've been struggling all season to do much of anything with it. He's coming up here to lap Korodovos, and he overdrives the turn, I see. I don't know what he was trying to do there, but I guess Meyer must have been struggling to get around Kostopoulos, because here comes Cameron Taylor for the lead. Cameron Taylor on the inside, and Meyer just lets Cameron Taylor go. Cameron Taylor in the 53. This team has just made the best decision they could have ever made by putting Cameron Taylor in the car. He was by far the best person they could have put in that car, and they made the best decision by putting him in, basically, is what I'm trying to say. Cameron Taylor now, he brought his sponsors to this team, gave him a lot of funding, and now they're giving him a car that he can run to the front with. Cameron Taylor, in the 53 now. He actually DNPQ'd his 77 because that car got caught up in an incident. And this is going to be a cool camera. We're on the rear camera of Nikos Kostopoulos in the 72. He's running four laps down at this point. We're watching the battle back there. And you see Zach Meyer get on the inside there, but his car's a bit loose at this point, it looks like. Rick Phillips, his day ends from 13th place. He was having a pretty good run, although just the experimental parts didn't hold together. I don't think he was planning on running the full race, but his ignition system finally dies on that car. Like I said before, experimental parts do that, I guess. And here we have Cody Deke four laps later, lap 73, and something breaks down. I think the rear suspension breaks on that car from 13th. 13th, the unlucky number, becomes the cursed position. So now two cars and four laps get taken out from that position. I wouldn't want to be whoever inherits that position now. But tough day for Cody Deke. He was running pretty good, and, well, I guess that's his day done right there. John Smith, a rookie, he's driving for BBS Racing, which is based out of Australia. He's managed to catch Claire Osier, who is running about a second off the pace of everybody else. Not sure if there's something wrong with that 21 car, but this is quickly turning into an exciting battle. John Smith, the rookie there. Now here, Preston Bell, he's had a pretty mediocre day. He's running in 16th, and this is the highest he's run all day. Not doing his championships any good, especially since Andy Lambert's in front of him. Azuma Kazuyama running in 25th, a lap down, and there goes the engine. He held on to it as long as he could. Victim of circumstance, another faulty ignition system. That's the third one today. And tough break for the 38 team. They were trying to make what they could with this race, hopefully get their name out there. And here's Greg Maddux running in 7th place, and he's doing an admirable job. You see Andy Lambert there in the 15 in 6th place in front of him. This team isn't going to exist next year, the 41 team, but Maddux is going to run for Winslot Racing in the number 7 car. He's going to take over the spot that Kyle Winsloff vacated at that team. Cameron Taylor's been going really fast lately. He's trying to come up and lap Ike Durbin here, but I guess he's slowed up right there as you saw him go a bit wide. I'm not sure exactly what his plan of action here is, and he goes wide there to try and get by Durbin again, and Meyer decides to take an opportunity, but his car's too loose to do that. You see him wiggle there, and he's been driving off in the final turn as well, Zach Meyer, in that 25. Next lap, Cameron Taylor tries to make another pass on Durbin, but I'm not sure what Cameron Taylor's thinking there, but Meyer makes another look on the inside. Meyer's got the preferred line, however, he doesn't in this turn. He tries to make a move, but overdrives the turn. Now we're going to watch on board from Ike Durbin here, the next lap. See, he puts a bit of distance on Cameron Taylor. Zach Meyer is just hounding Taylor for that position, and Taylor moves wide again. Meyer looks to the inside, and Meyer just can't make nothing of it. He just keeps hounding Cameron Taylor lap after lap. Greg Woodard here is running in 18th place. Good run so far for Woodard, the debut driver. He's going to be running with Terra International Motorsports next year. He's got himself a two-car operation set up for next season. He's going to be running for Rookie of the Year. Good luck to him. He's championing this Lycoya Interceptor here. Zach Meyer, he's been hounding this 53 car in front of him for the past good five laps or so, and it looks like he's going to make another charge this next lap. And the ignition system just went on the 25. You've got to be kidding me. Once again, I need to say, does anybody really want to win this race? However, Cameron Taylor seems to want to win this race, as he seems to be the last man standing at this point. Cameron Taylor in the 53. This team just made an excellent decision on bringing him on board with all of his sponsorship money. He's doing this team a lot of good, and I honestly couldn't think of anybody better that they could have brought on, but just a massive heartbreak for Zach Meyer in that 25 car. He was just having the run of his career, basically. Novakovsky here is running in 7th place in front of both of his teammates, and he really might be the better driver of the three. And green flag pit stops are kicked off on lap 93. Steve Johnson in the 900 and Preston Bell from 15th and 16th place bring their cars in. You can see a couple other cars there. John Bracci and David Kerkorian already pulling out of their pits. The next lap, the 53 of Cameron Taylor, he brings his car into the pit lane. Looks like nothing's going to happen to this car at this point. AJ Murphy experiencing some problems from 21st on lap 93 in turn 2 here. This car has been running all right this race, just having a few problems here and there. Hood damage early on slowed him down. Tough break for the 76, the Ohio short tracker in front of his home crowd. Greg Maddux hasn't pit yet, so he's going to lead this lap here, lap 94. And Greg Maddux doing all he can to show that he is a very capable driver. Early in the season, he was out of the top 30 in points, but he worked his way in the hard way. He actually missed a few races here and there in the season, and he's going to lead this lap right there. Actually, no, he isn't. Cameron Taylor got him at the line. Cameron Taylor takes the lead. He snatches another lap from Greg Maddux, but he pulls out to a big lead once again. It looks like nothing's going to happen to Cameron Taylor here in the 53. It appears that his car might hold out for the rest of the race. There's only about 30 laps to go at this point. Josh Marshall's car, however, will not hold out on him, and he blows up on lap 95 from 21st position. Tough break for him. He had a good run going at Road Atlanta earlier in the season. He would have won that race. However, a couple lap cars messed with his chances. He's going to come back and have a go at next year in that same car. David Kerkorian and John Bracci are battling for 9th place here. And Kerkorian has recovered pretty well from his earlier incident of stalling out. And he looks like he's going to salvage a top 10 out of this deal. Gaspar D'Souza is running in 15th place right now, just in front of Greg Woodard. And he's run a pretty anonymous race. He's not really done much. He's going to come back with this team next year. This car is going to be number 92, and they're going to update their model to the Cretac. John Bracci, as I mentioned before, he's been running pretty strong today. He's passed up to 6th now on lap 104. That battle that we showed with John Bracci before was 5 laps before that. Louis Ballard has had a pretty anonymous day as well. He's running in 14th place. He hasn't really done too much. As you see, he's right in front of Gaspar D'Souza. He's just kind of hanging around, just trying to get a good points day in, it looks like. John Smith has moved up to 2nd place. He's working on passing Ike Durbin here when he dives into the pits. I think he needs to pit to get more fuel. They didn't get quite enough fuel in the car on that last pit stop, and I think there's a couple other cars, including Bracci, who need to do so. It's about lap 110 right now, and a few cars who weren't getting good fuel economy did decide to come in later that lap, including Bracci. Claire Ossier is in her own zip code. As you see, there's nobody around her for a good 10 seconds in either way. You see the closest cars are right there in turn 2, and Ossier is just running in 2nd, just trying to hold her ground and hope nothing happens to her car. Ossier never really a benefactor from others' mistakes. She's definitely going to benefit today. With about 10 laps to go, the action's really starting to heat up here. There's Preston Bell and Sergei Yakovsky battling for 19th place. Both cars are a lap down, and there's AJ Murphy, who's 2 laps down. Something's definitely wrong with that car. I don't know if he dropped a cylinder or not. But Yakovsky and Murphy make contact, and here comes Kowalczyk to snake his way through. Kowalczyk in 3rd place. He managed to get by Maddux a couple laps ago for that position. And here is Kowalczyk running in 3rd place on lap 115. There's only 10 laps to go at this point, and they're battling pretty fiercely. Maddux is behind him in 4th, and there you see Novakovsky in 5th battling with Carroll and Smith for that position. And they're just jostling for position, as you see here. 10 laps to go. He gets slowed up by Murphy, and Novakovsky goes into the wall, exiting the final turn. Novakovsky falls back to 7th place. Rough lap for the Russian, but he's looking like he's going to hold on to that position. He doesn't need to pit, but there's definitely damage on that car. 9 laps to go. You see Maddox got by Kowalczyk for 4th place. 5th, not 4th, 3rd, excuse me. But Kowalczyk brings his car into the pits, and there's a fire under the hood, a turbo fire under the hood. I think they're going to try and put that out, but I don't know if they can do so. Tough break for Kowalczyk. He was running so well. He was running in 4th place at that point. However, for the last 9 laps, nobody could touch Cameron Taylor, and Cameron Taylor will take the win at the Cleveland Grand Prix, driving for Zenus Enterprises. Zenus made an excellent decision by putting Cameron Taylor in that car. 9th place goes to Louis Ballard. As you see right here, this was pretty amusing. He blows up coming to the line, trying as hard as he can to get that crippled car across the line, and he does so, finishing in 9th place at a blistering 20 miles per hour. He parks his car right there, right after the stripe. Excellent effort for Louis Ballard to get that car across the line. Aussier held on for 2nd. Greg Maddox, he moved up to 3rd after Kowalczyk's turbo fire. Kowalczyk, they tried to put out the fire, but they weren't successful. But they never actually pulled that car into the garage, so he was still listed as running 9 laps down. Edward Carroll, he moved up to 4th place after that great run for him in his last run at Paloma Autosport. He's going to Lucas Motorsports next year. John Smith, P5, best finish of his career. Grigory Novakovsky, great run for the debut driver. He did all he could, especially after that loose wheel. He still managed to work his way back up to 6th. Samuel Brown ran a pretty anonymous race in that number 7. Andy Lambert held on for 9th. Louis Ballard, in that excellent effort to get his crippled car across the line, finishes 9th. And Gaspar D'Souza finishes in 10th, 1 lap down. And now, for the moment you've all been waiting for, your 2011 PCC Cup Series champion is... We'll be right back.